which we're celebrating the 60th anniversary of this church. This church has existed under three different names. The first name was the Bethel Baptist Church. The second name was the First Southern Baptist Church. And the current name of the church is the Living Hope Baptist Church, but we've been the Southern Baptist Church since 1955 when it incorporated. And it's a great day. I'm so glad you could come to join us. There are others that are still coming in this morning. We're going to be recognizing just a couple of people during the service, but during the luncheon, if you are here as a guest from the, I'm going to say the past, one of the heroes of faith of this church, while we're over in the tent having lunch, there will be a time in which we have a microphone and we'll make it available to you to just say a greeting to your brothers and sisters, maybe say just a few words, please, about what you've been up to since you left here. And so that's one of the things we want to accomplish today. And as I said, there will be a luncheon following this. You should have, when you came in, received an envelope, and on it we'll have your table number, so that when we're dismissed here today to go to the lunch, we're going to pray for the food here, so I know you Baptists. It's like when you get over there, you don't want to be waiting around for somebody to pray so you can eat. So there will be two food lines, and we have chicken and beef. If you want something else to eat, I'll pass the kitchen if they have peanut butter and jelly. So either chicken, beef, or maybe some peanut butter jelly, I guess. Anyway, we have, I think, just a great service in store for us today. I'm going to be speaking some about the past, and unusual for me, I'm going to be listing and recognizing things that happened over these past 60 years and thinking about where are we going in the future. That's very, very important. By the way, one of the pastors of this church from the past is here with us this morning. It's Pastor Stan Fogle, and he's sitting right over here. Is it all right if I tell him it was 52 years ago and you have a live mic? Did you want to say a word? Or you want to lead us in opening prayer? You don't have to do a thing. It's ready to go.
We came to this church 52 years ago. I think it was this month when we called, I think the church called me. And we had the best 8 years of our life at this church. And after we left, I left because I thought it would be good for the church, because I didn't have any seminary, and I finished my college after coming here. And I thought, if I leave, the church is in a position they could call an experienced pastor that could do better than I could. But they didn't do that. So it's so good to be back, and I like to be recognized. And the reason I like to be recognized, I want to encourage people that are old. I'm 93. And I encourage people not to quit serving the Lord just because of their age. Just keep on going. Thank you, Lord, for your love and your patience with us. Thank you for this Baptist church and their pastor and what they've done here. And thank you that you're going to send revival to this nation. And we've been praying for it for 8 years. And we still believe you're going to intercede. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name.
Brother, and you should have stayed here. God only knows what would have happened if you'd have just stayed here. Be good. Anyway, what we need to do at this point, I think, is to continue in worship, I think, at this point. So, brother, you ready to lead us? Let's worship the Lord.
Thank you. Global, I think it is. I don't know what 93 is supposed to look like, but you're not it. That's pretty amazing. It is really good for me to be here. For a couple of reasons. One of which is that, celebrating a place that's been a beacon in a city for 60 years is pretty amazing. That's a big deal. And two, you're loving on my mom and dad, which is a big deal to me. I'm a preacher's kid.
Amen.
Okay. That is, in general, seldom said in reverence.
That's true.
But it is something that I revere. I am proud. I look back over a lifetime with my mom and dad pouring into people's lives. And a big part of my dad's ministry, and certainly my mom's ministry, has been in music. And my dad led choirs all my life. And my dad could hear a bad note with 70 people. Quick. He didn't fool around in my dad's choirs. It was all about, hey. And so the music fell to me. It's what I do. I chase songs. I write songs. That's part of my living. And I don't chase a song unless something knocks me over about it. The idea's got to knock me over, you know. And it happened with this song I heard a few years back, and somebody was talking about, man, that Adam and Eve really opened up a can of worms and did a number on all of us, you know. And I thought, well, I was given the same choice. And I made the same choice. So, I don't know if I buy that so much. It really comes down to me, you know. We'll sing like the pick of locks off a Pandora's box. Set the demons to flight. When Adam and Eve took a bite, I guess they thought the garden was not enough for them. But let's face it, you and me, we'd have picked something off that tree. Most days my sins are simple and small. A lapse in judgment, a slip and fall. There have been days I've been amazed at the things that I let happen. Sometimes I don't know me from Adam. I know I let the devil's voice twist my thoughts and color my choice. Tell me I could find more truth in the taste of forbidden fruit. Walk through more than one foolish door in my endless search for wanting more. And put the blame on something else and had to hide and cover myself. Most days my sins are simple and small. A lapse in judgment, to slip and fall. There have been days I've been amazed at the things that I let happen. Sometimes I don't know me from Adam. From Adam and Eve, and at my best I could be them. I'm looking for greener grass than Eden. Most days my sins are simple and small. Laughs in judgment to slip and fall. But there have been days I've been amazed at the things that I let happen. Sometimes I don't know me from Adam. Sometimes I don't know me from Adam. Good to be here.
While I'm up here, I would like to ask you to open your Bibles and find the book of Hebrews, chapter 11. I'm going to read a couple of verses out of that, but got some important things to share with you about faith and faithfulness. That's what's on my heart today, is faithfulness. And before we do that, I want to recognize people that are here, and I know there. If y'all think about it, there's no way I could call out people in this crowd and be able to not miss somebody in the crowd. So I can't do that at the service here, but in the luncheon we'll have a microphone. If you have things you want to share, we'll give you opportunities to introduce yourself. Tell us what you've been doing since you've been here. Some of your visiting today, and we're very, very glad that you're here, by the way. We would not exist as a church if it weren't for those who went before us and made it possible, like you, brother. Sounds like maybe you should have stayed more than 8 years. That would have been good. I'm all for staying longer, right? And I'll prove that in a moment. I would like to just for a second see who's here very quickly, and I want to ask, is there anyone here that was a member of this church or attending here before 1960? Anybody? If you would just stand up a second. I see one over here before 1960. Dr. Glenn Newman. God bless you. Anyone else? Wow. Oh. R.J. Stevens. R.J. was baptized as a child in this church, and it's awesome. Robert, what did I say? Robert. Excuse me, Robert. I know you're Robert. By the way, I won't make that mistake if you and Leslie join the church today. I told her I was going to say that. Anyway, that's one. How about not before 1970? Before 1970. Anybody before 1970? Wow. Great. Glad you're here. Glad you're here. This is great. Good to see you. How about anybody that was attending here before 1980? Anybody? Wonderful. Great. Glad you could join us today. Every single one. That's a fact. How about before 1990? Now we're going back 25 plus years. God bless you. Each one. Thank you for being here today. I see somebody over there that sings like a bird. I know who that is. And somebody else. Is there somebody here that's been here since before 2000, that's 15 or more years ago. Anybody? Wow. Thank you. I'm glad you're here. This is great. I'm very, very glad. Okay, you can be seated. Well, that was very good. And everybody else has been here since this year, 2015, back to 2000. So we know who that is. I'm glad that you're all here. I want us to pray before I read Scripture. We're going to stand and read Scripture. So if you would stand with me for reading Scripture. And before we do, we have a brother, one of our deacons and a trustee in our church who was taken to the ER at the beginning of the service, and that's Clarence Fields.
Wow.
And so he is those who made that possible to get him there. Let's pray. Father, we just come before you. We want to pray for our brother Clarence. I know he very, very much wanted to be here with us this morning, but his health was precluding that. I want to pray that the care he receives there will help him to determine what's the cause of this problem, and that they'll be able to give him some help this morning to get that stabilized. So thank you for being with Pat and Clarence. I know they just really wanted to be here. And then, Lord, I'm glad you're here. You know, we recognize everybody else. I think we need to stop and remember, we're standing in the presence of God in this place. Lord, you're the one that made it possible for every one of us to hear the good news of Jesus Christ, to be saved. You're the one who gave us new life when we deserved death. You're the one who loved us in spite of ourselves, even though everybody in the whole room has been like Adam or Eve at some point in our life. And I thank you that you've saved us now and given us new life in Christ. So I pray, as we read your word, you'll hear your voice. May I decrease and may you increase in this place, and may we realize we're in the presence of God and this is your word. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Touch on the fact. Hebrews 11 verse 1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, for by it by faith. The elders obtained a good testimony. By faith, we understand the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. Faith requires trusting in God, even though I can't see Him, I know He's there. Now I want to go to the end of that chapter, the last two verses. In between what we just read and these two verses is this list of the heroes of faith. And I'm going to make a comment about that in a minute. We read it and we would recognize them, but I want you to know why this list is here. It's not because we witnessed. It's because someone else witnessed. It's his testimony. It says, all these, having obtained a good testimony through faith, did not receive the promise. God, having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. There is one faith, one hope, one baptism, one body in Christ. All these heroes of faith down through the centuries were part of that, the one body. So when we read this list of these heroes of faith, how would it be if we would ask God to add our name to the list in the rest of our life? We want to live by His grace through faith and obedience the rest of our life. Just dedicate ourselves to become, by God's help, a hero, a heroine of faith. That's my message today, what I want to talk about. First point, we have an outline today, and I want us to take a look at the first point on that outline. I want to talk about the past, the testimony of faithfulness to God. And every time I come to a message, I pray about it, and I was thinking about the topic, and I said, I need to take some time to think about the past, because the present wouldn't exist, and we have no future if there wasn't the past. So I was thinking about that, and that required me to look in the mirror. Now, I've told you before that my main mirror is this. This is my mirror. I see myself reflected on the pages of God's mirror, the Word of God. But I began thinking about myself. When I look in a glass mirror and I see myself, what I see, quite frankly, is an older pastor who has gained patience through my journey. And those of you who are wise will understand what I just said. I've gained patience. For those of you that don't know, tribulation worketh patience. You don't gain patience by having an easy life at all. You reach a point in life where you know that you're not going to live forever. I see myself, I see a photograph of myself, and I look even older in a photograph than I do in the mirror. My own mind, I trick myself. I think I'm still younger. I feel younger. But I want you to know that even though I know I'm not going to live forever, I want to be like Caleb. I'm still climbing the mountain God gave me. I'm not done climbing yet. When He pulls me off the mountain, I'm glad to go. But until then, I'm climbing. Our children are all grown up. Our grandchildren are 17 to 21 years of age. The oldest was 3 years old when I came to this town. The youngest was not yet born. So what will our children and grandchildren find when I'm gone? What are they going to see? What about when you're gone? What will your children and grandchildren find? What sort of a legacy are you and I leaving behind? What if people were to come to our home after we're gone and go through all of our junk and stuff? On one hand, they're going to say, I wish they would have gotten rid of some of this stuff before they died. Dad never played golf, but he's got 3 sets of golf clubs. Like, why? And all these books. Who in the world would ever read real books? It's like, we got digital books. I get into my netbook and all that, but I have real books. I still read real books. if they check around, you got some one more. Would they know that we live by faith by what they find? Would they know that we love the Lord? Would they know that we love their neighbors? Would they know that we honored the Bible? Would they know that we were followers of Jesus Christ by what they find? I'm going to make a suggestion. It's not in my notes, but I'm going to suggest this. In your personal favorite Bible, please write a letter to each of your friends and family members for them to find someday. And when you get to that end, you know, I don't carry it around now, but slip those in if you can before you go, or have a note in your Bible that says you'll find letters. That's another way to do it. You'll find an envelope with letters in it. I want you to write a love letter to everybody you know. Personal letters. Give your testimony of your faith. Tell them what God's done in your life. Tell them what you prayed for them in their life. Some of your most powerful words may be a treasure that you leave to each of your loved ones so they'll find it and you can make sure they know and hear the gospel one more time. They know they should serve Jesus one more time. That you wanted to leave a legacy and that the reason you kept serving God is because you wanted to keep climbing. So you look back over the cover of our bulletins and you know what it says? Tick the bulletin. To the back. Bulletin. I have this thing. I had somebody tell me one time, why don't you take this off? I said, because I'm hoping someday somebody will read it. I'm not going to read all this, but it just says a few things that are dear to my heart. You see, I have a love letter to you on the back. I'm hoping someday you'll take the time, somebody will take the time and actually read this thing. It's to you. I said, we proclaim God's message with practical application from the Bible. Here in this church, you're going to find love and acceptance and hope and forgiveness and opportunities to grow and serve God and one another. Then drop down. It's got a lot of other things you can read about it, but it just says, it's our prayer that our church will be a place where all who enter know God is our hope. Talk about hope. It's Him. He's our hope. Second, everyone who leaves here will know God by faith. And third, that all people would know God's love through us. If you don't know those things, you don't know us. That's who I'm going to be when I grow up. Okay? It's just on the back of the bulletin cover, a few thoughts. I wonder, will those who come behind you and me, will they know that we were faithful to God? Will they know that? And I find myself overwhelmed as I think about the challenge of living like the heroes of the faith of Hebrews 11 and the heroes of faith who established and grew this church. Faith always involves the unseen. It always means you got to step out in faith and you don't know what God's going to do yet. When you do, you just know that He's giving you this impression or spoken to you or someone else and you've had confirmation and you know you're supposed to do something and you step out. Oh, the ground held me. One more time. I can keep taking steps, okay? But faith always involves that. And the Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things that are not seen. You know, by faith we see what the world cannot see. The world always tells us, well, seeing is believing. If I see it, then I'll believe it. God says believing is seeing. So if you're a believer, you and I understand that what we really see is when we have faith in Jesus Christ, He opens our eyes to see things that other people cannot see at all. So the fact is, we believe, therefore we see. So this chapter defines faith by describing actually how it works. And faith always wins God's approval. It always wins His approval. Hebrews 11:2 says, for by it the elders obtained a good testimony. And I've always said this, that God honors faith that honors God. God honors faith that honors God. And Hebrews 11 verse 2 tells us something. It says, for by it the elders obtained a good testimony. The testimony was not by the religious leaders or the scribes. You and I know that. The testimony was God. When his children obey him and step out in faith, God says, amen. He says, I'm pleased when you obey me and follow me and step out in faith. Moses stood up for righteousness. David slew Goliath. Hebrew children refused to bow down. Nehemiah rebuilt walls. Elijah defeated the prophets of Baal. God looked down from heaven and he said again, amen, amen, amen. And someone gave their life for him and he stands. He stands because he's proud of you when you're obedient to him and when you follow him and when you love him with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And I want to talk for a moment, because it is God who does the witnessing. The one we worship, the one we want to please is God. I've heard preachers say, can I get a witness? I've done it. Pastor Kirk, I don't know if you've ever done that. Can I get a witness? We're trying to wake up the guy on the back row. I used to ask the deacons, I'd say, there's a guy back there sleeping in the back. Would you go back there and wake him up? You know what the deacons told me? Brother, you put him to sleep, you go back there and wake him up. I love deacons. But they tell it like it is, you know what I mean? That's why they're deacons. This church began as a Bible study at the Women's Club in 1954 up in Pastor Rayford was the one who got that started, I believe. Is that right, Ken? You know that. But yeah. Yeah. And then in 1956, they had their first meeting in the A building. That's the office building now. 1959, after the first 4 years, they had accumulated 49 baptisms, 8 deacons, and they changed their name to First Southern Baptist Church. And their pastor was at that time as the Gus Prince. In 1961, they called Pastor Wayne Fuller. They dedicated the B building in 63. 63, Pastor Fuller got appointed to the foreign mission field and he became an international missionary. And then they called this gentleman over here, Pastor Stan Fogel. I'm glad they did. 1964, they established a mission church. The Valley Vista Baptist Church was established as a mission of this church. 67, the C building was built. That's the building where they have a children room upstairs and a kitchen and fellowship hall downstairs. 69, we had a bus ministry. Let's see, how old were you in 1969? You weren't. He weren't born yet. Yeah. It's bad English, but it's a fact. He weren't born yet. We had a bus ministry in this church then. 71, they called Pastor Alex Campbell. I'm going to go through these quickly because you can read. In 1972, they began the XYZ ministry, which has continued for 43 years. They have a service in rest homes throughout our community every week. We go to the homes, we sing songs, hymns, and that's what those people know, it's hymns. So we just sing hymns and we have a Bible devotional. 1974, we dedicated the Worship Center D, you know, the building that has the upstairs, downstairs, used to be no floor in it. It used to be just the Worship Center. But they planned to install floors later. 77, they called Dr. Charles McKay. He was the interim pastor. 77, they called Pastor Buddy Reeves. And during that time, they purchased the rest of the land that went all the way to San Jacinto Street, filled that out. In 79, they did a building program for this building, 750-seat worship center. In 1980, they had two worship services still going in the previous building because they couldn't hold them all. And they had a mission church with Pastor Luis Arroyo and his dear wife is here today. Is he preaching this morning?
He's at a men's retreat.
At a men's retreat. He escaped. She sings wonderful. We should have got you up here to sing. Oh, what a blessing. Luis is blessed. Let's say that. So the church is still going, the church that was started as a mission. And in 84, they dedicated this current building. In 86, the city of Hammond required the church to add cinder block walls all around this 7 acres. Very expensive project. They paid for that. 86, they licensed Jeffrey Woods to the gospel ministry, and he went to Wayland Baptist University. That is a testimony of this church that numerous times young men were called to the ministry, and the church saw that and affirmed them and scholarshiped them or wrote letters to affirm them to go on to school. That's happened numerous times. In 88, they completed the preschool building. In 89, Pastor Buddy Reeves left, and Dr. Thurman George, those of you who know him, came as an interim. In 1990, Dr. David Hall came as a pastor in March, and he resigned in September. This is one of the sad, darkest days in the history of our church, for this church. But one of the things that happened as an outshoot of that is the Hemet Valley Baptist Church was started. And what's interesting today about that is, for the kingdom, men and women, boys and girls come today who don't know anything about all that. That's 25 years ago. Don't know anything about it, and people are getting saved and led to become disciples. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose, right? So, it's scripture. 1991, they called Pastor Julian Clark, and they started a homebound ministry. In 91, they also endorsed Jeffrey Woods. He was continuing. Went on to Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. In 94, David Daffern was called as the Minister of Education and Youth. George Engel came in 95 as a Minister of Music. 96, the church issued a church vocational scholarships to three men, Aaron Daffern, Joshua Daffern, and George Elrick. So we had three young men that went on to school. In 96, David Daffern resigned, accepted the senior pastor at a church in Arizona. In 97, Pastor Julian Clark resigned. And this is the church's really their weird days. They actually called me as their interim pastor. I came here as a vice president at Cal Baptist, and I came here just to fill the pulpit while they're searching. And I made the mistake on my first day of saying, we need to fill these pews. Somebody said, we? Be careful what you say behind the pulpit. In 98, they installed me as a senior pastor, and they've not been able to get rid of me since. In 2000, John Miller was sponsored to go to seminary, another young man. In 2000, John Carter was called as a music minister. Shekinah Missionary Baptist was also launched here. Mary Ellen Van Ostenbridge came as a minister of music. Robert Poe was called the next year as a minister of music. Then 2006, Mountain View Community Church leased facilities, and that launched as a new church, which became Diamond Valley Baptist Church. In 2008, Mark Nelson came as an interim minister of music, and he just keeps coming back. And sitting next to him, I have a laser, but I won't shine it on you. Sitting next to him is Bart Young. And Bart, when were you minister of music here? 82 to 90. And he's singing in the choir because Mark wouldn't let him go. See, you have to sing. Pretty cool, isn't it? I'm glad you're here. And your wife's singing over here. Praise God, this is wonderful. Yeah, it's great. Put him to work. Mark warned him. He said, don't go to lunch with Pastor Rick and put you to work. I said, it's too late. 2009, Robert Zitt came as our first family life minister. In 2010, we replaced the roof. This roof leaked since it was built. From 1984 in 2010, just like Pat, you have a son, Kirk, I have a son, Jonathan, and we used to come out here with 55 buckets and try to find where the drips were going to go. And we would set, every time it rained, we set 55 buckets in here. Finally, we replaced the roof. I got to say, praise God, hallelujah, we've got a roof that does not leak. And then the church, Diamond Valley, moved to a new location, and Bob Zitt resigned. He got to where his eyesight would prevent him to continue. And Dr. Dewey Squires, sitting right over here, was called as our associate pastor for family ministry. And I delivered a sermon in 2012. The sermon was from Proverbs 3, chapters, verses 5 through 10, and explained we must honor the Lord with all our possessions. That's what the scripture says. And Parkway Baptist Church needed a place to meet, and our church agreed unanimously to vote to invite them to come and use the facilities here, and they accepted, and they began meeting in our location, and I'm so delighted they had a place to meet. I'm going to have Pastor Kirk come up when I get him to the present. We're almost there. We burned the note. We are debt-free today. People have heard me say that I would not resign as pastor until we were debt-free. Everybody started rumoring when we were debt-free that I was leaving. And I said, it's not the only thing I said. I just said, I want to be debt-free. Do you know what these people wanted to do? Take out another loan. Like, they won't let me go. So, 2013, they elected a documents committee, which in almost interminably began rewriting our documents, and it's completed, and we have some very, very outstanding documents for this church to protect it. And I delivered another sermon, 2 Peter 1:3, which says that Jesus Christ is our living hope because of his resurrection. And I said that we need to be an example to our community. People aren't looking for, no disrespect, I'm a Southern Baptist, but no, people are not looking for a First Southern. They're looking for hope. And our hope has to be based upon a relationship with Jesus Christ. So we decided to change our name to Living Hope Baptist Church. It's a very biblical name. 2014, we asked Steve Flynn to come as our minister of music. We also renovated the worships. He came in the middle of a renovation, I think, and we finished renovating. We paid $132,000 and change to complete renovating this facility here. It's paid for in cash. Mark Nelson called to serve as our business administrator in the same year. It's a big year. And Tom Catanzaro was ordained to the ministry of the gospel this year. Isn't that awesome? It's like we're seeing progression. Young man, you call. Glory to God. Oh, and then you're here. I had to add that in. 60th anniversary. So, second thing, I want to talk about some present things that are going on. And one of the things that I wanted to share was in Hebrews 11:39, it says, "And all these heroes of the past, having obtained a good testimony of God through faith, didn't receive the promise." The heroes of faith did not receive the promise, but we did. Do you realize how blessed you are to be living today? We know Jesus is the Son of God. He came to be our Savior. He took our sin. He died on the cross. He was buried. He arose from death to live forever as our Lord and our Savior. Knowing Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior is the most important takeaway from this meeting. It's the most important thing for you to know. Jesus is the reason that those who came before us worked so hard and sacrificed so much to make it possible for us to be here today. We are debt-free. That's a big deal in this economy now. We recently refurbished this place. It's not in bad shape. 5 out of 6 roofs have been replaced and they're paid for. We are training a young man again for the ministry of the gospel. That's what you're supposed to be doing. And Parkway Baptist Church is growing and I'm so excited. Pastor Kirk, I want you to come up and share what's on your heart. Just come on up, come on up. Tell us about your experience here since you were able to come over and meet here. So, use this one? Okay.
He asked me to take the next hour and 45 minutes. Talk about our church. I'm just kidding you. I didn't know your history. Thank you for sharing that with us, Pastor. What I see is a history of planting churches and sending young men out in the ministry. And I don't know what a greater thing a church can do besides to duplicate itself and prepare more people for the gospel. Our church was started, it's been a while now, my wife and I started it 17 years ago. We started with nothing. We didn't know anybody here in town. It's a long story, and I won't go into it. But to say, 3 years ago, we leased a property, the DMV property here in Emmett. And our church, the people we leased it from, did not make the mortgage payments on the property. We even knew that they weren't, but we felt like to honor our lease agreement, we still had to do to pay them. Pastor Rick called me one day and said, "Kirk, how you doing?" And I said, "Do you really want to know how I'm doing, or is this like one of those 'how you doing'? And I'm supposed to say I'm doing great, you know?" And he goes, "I want to know how you're doing. Why don't you come over here and talk to me?" And I told him that our church was in a seriously desperate strait. I didn't know what we were going to do, know where we were going to go, what are we going to do? And Pastor Rick, through the Holy Spirit, I believe, and allowing him to work in, Pastor Rick asked us, of course he brought it to you first. He came to my church and preached a sermon and invited our church to come meet on this property. I've never heard of anything like that. I've never heard of that kind of a spirit from a pastor or from a church. You guys have changed our life. God has used you to do great things for the kingdom of God. And I just came here to, first of all, say thank you, Pastor Rick, for what you've done. I know that, but thank you for that. I want to tell you all, most of you are here, and we leave. We have Sunday school at 8 o'clock in the morning. That's really exciting. And we have church at 9:15. That works out okay. But the Lord has just grown our church, and I want to just say, I want to thank you for this. I believe, I could be wrong, I know God can do anything, all things work together for good, but I believe that if it wasn't for Pastor Rick, I'm not sure that our church would exist right now. I mean that. I don't know that we would have gone on. And my wife knows that. Our church in the last 3 years since we've been here, Pastor Rick, has seen 760 people saved in this valley. Our church has had 81 baptisms in the past 3 years. We've had 80 people joined by membership. Our church is experiencing phenomenal growth. We know, and we know it's all the Lord's will, but we know that, and we're very appreciative. One of our deacons is here today, David Sealscott's in the front row with his wife. One of our trustees, Jerry Mullins, is here with his wife in the front row. And we know that God gets the honor and the glory, but we know that we're thankful for each of you that allowed us to be here and to be a part of your work and what the Lord's doing here. So thank you so much for all that you've done for us.
I'm still trying to get used to him. He's just a bit younger than I am, but he's awesome. He's a Baptist. He loves the Bible, and he loves people. He's actually a pastor. You know, some are preachers. He's a pastor and a great preacher. And I love you, brother. I love your wife, your family. He has a great family. I didn't say anything about April and the kids, but you can see God working through his ministry as you see the children growing up faithful. I saw your son over there with a shirt and tie on, and he was helping, and I needed something carried, and one of the other young men came up and carried it for me, and I just thought how neat it is to see young people who want to serve. It was very neat that they just did that. Wouldn't even let me take it back. He just said, "No, I'm carrying this for you. This is my job as a ministry." So I thought, they're learning too. That's good. Anyway, our future, what's it going to be? A testimony of, that's where I want us to think now. You know, the past is the past. I'm thankful for it. I'm thankful for those who went before us. But we need to be thinking today about 2016 and beyond. Where are we going? God having provided something better for us, that they should not be made perfect apart from us. Do you realize that everything we do by faith He's accompanied by all the heroes of faith. And someday, we're going to be standing in a big crowd of the faithful before the Lord. And I'm wondering, is he going to say one by one, good and faithful friend? Or is he going to say, good and faithful friend, and good and faithful all y'all? You know, I know the Lord isn't from the South, but I was thinking someday the recognition of the saints will be all of us, not just one of us or a few of us, but all of the believers will be together. And I look forward to that day to look back and say, I want to say thank you to the heroes in the past. And I also want to say, I hope that I continue to be faithful myself. So what would those who went before us think about what we're doing today? Would, if Moses was here, or Joseph, there's a great hero of faith. If Joseph was here, would he say, you're doing really well, or I got a few thoughts for you here. So what would these want be in the past? What would they say about what we're doing? And my question is, what will those who come behind us say about us? What are they going to say? We have a new ministry we're starting, by the way, by request, because there's so many that have lost loved ones in our community and in our church. We're starting a new ministry called Grief Share, Look Into the Future. So this coming Thursday, there will be an informational meeting, and you find the information is in your bulletin. You can read that about that. That's available for anyone. It's just whoever comes, it will be a biblical way of working through grief. And in the future, did you see the sign over here? On the dirt that's been just freshly graded, there's a sign that says, Future God's Multipurpose Building. Future location, God's Multipurpose Building. We're going to need a bigger fellowship hall here. And I like that. I love fellowship. So there's a song, and I want us to sing this song. It's a song that Steve Green wrote, and I know where he got most of the words and ideas. It's out of Hebrews 11. It just happened to fit it when I looked at it. I went, Hebrews 11, where's Steve? You ready to lead us in this song? I actually have all the words for the song right here. Is that good? I did one thing right.
Y'all want to stand and join us?
We'll start and join us all.
Hey.
thinking about what is our legacy to those who follow us. What's our legacy? You ever seen these perpetual plaques that are in hospitals and schools and some churches? And it has the names of people who donated money in the past, built buildings and put in pews and all that. They always lift the names of people who made these gifts to make the building possible. But have you ever noticed, if you look carefully on every perpetual plaque, you'll see there's always room for more names. Always room for more names. Now that's one for giving. I'm not talking about that right now. There's always room for you, and there's always room for me to be added to the list of heroes of faith. What's our response to that? My question is, who will be the next hero of faith? And my question to you is, why not you? Why not you? Who will respond to God's call? Why not you? And who will stand up against the world? Why not you? And who will step out in faith? Why not you? And who will march around the walls? If God calls us to, why not you? And who will dream big dreams for God? Why not you? Who will lead the way for your family to follow? Why not you? And who will risk opposition from the world? Will you? Will you risk that? It's coming. So who's going to be the next Abraham? And who's the next Sarah? And who's the next David? And who's the next Esther? Will you? Who will give up the pleasures of this world for the sake of the cross of Jesus Christ? Will you? And if you're willing to put your faith in God and you're willing to obey Him, then will you step forward today? I'm going to extend an invitation to everyone. It's not to join this church. It's to step out in faith and say, I want to dedicate or rededicate my life to become a hero of faith if God would enable me. I want to be a follower of Christ. I want to rededicate myself to be obedient and set the example to all who come behind me. And I say to you, may all who come behind us find us faithful. What I'm going to do is ask you to step up and come forward. I don't even need a song. I'm just going to say to you, if you're willing to be used of God and to rededicate or dedicate yourself to become a faithful follower of Christ or continue to be so, would you come forward and then I want us to pray together. You don't have to join the church. It could be any Christian that wants to come and rededicate yourself to follow Christ. Will you stand? Come on up. And if you can't come forward, it's okay. I know we can pray right where you are. This is to Him, by the way, not us. Let's pray. Father, we come before you. We just say, I want to be that man or that woman, that boy, that girl, that someday you could say, well done, good and faithful servant, even well done, good and faithful friend. I want to be that person who keeps climbing the mountain that you've given me, who stays in the race and never drops out. Step after step, climb after climb, hill after hill, obstacle after obstacle. I want to keep my eyes. God, help us, each of us, to keep our eyes on the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ. I pray always your word would be the authority in our life. Always we would seek to do everything we do for the kingdom of God and your righteousness. Because I know everything else we need, you'll provide it. You provide it as long as we seek you in your way. I want to pray for each of these who stepped forward and maybe some who couldn't, standing in the pew where they are, that we would together rededicate ourselves this time to do whatever the Lord wants in obedience, wherever our church is, whether it's here or far away, to make a difference for the kingdom wherever we are, that others will see in us the faith of Caleb, Joshua, the faith of those who went before us and made it possible for us to even stand here in this building. I love you, Lord, and I know those who stepped forward this morning, we all love you and we want your will to be done in our life and in this church and in the churches that are all represented here by every guest who's here with us this morning. We love you, Lord, now. Empower us by the Holy Spirit. Speak to us when we read the Bible. We want to know your will. We need your power, and we need your resources to do whatever you ask us to do. And thank you. Let your requests be known with thanksgiving. So I want to thank you for helping us to do all the things you want us to do for you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And Brother Darrell, it's wonderful to have you over here. He's our area missionary. And Kirk, we have a missionary over regions or areas of churches, and he happens to have this Inland Empire area. So, brother?
Well, good morning. Almost afternoon. Just a couple moments. It is really an honor to be here. Inland Empire Association is a very blessed association because of the Lord and great previous leadership. I represent about 225, 230 churches who truly express their gratitude to you. I was thinking, Pastor Fogle, when you came, I doubt there was 200 churches here, probably about just a handful in our association. Which means over the years, we've planted about 200 churches. You've been a part of every one of those church plants. Every church that was planted and got going that's reaching up today, you were a part of. Every person we say we've trained through the years to equip for excellence in other events, your church has been a part of training every one of those people. And so your faithfulness has made a significant impact on the kingdom work of God and in an empire. And I don't stand before you with a token appreciation, but with a genuine, heartfelt appreciation from churches who just value your partnership over the years and are beneficiaries of your faithfulness over the years and their particular ministries. And so they thank God for you and rejoice in your anniversary and look forward to God continuing your kingdom work, his kingdom work in this area. We had this made. Again, this is not token. This is genuine. The words of this are from our churches that you partner with. It simply says, congratulations on 60 years of evangelism, discipleship ministry, and missions giving. Your efforts and diligence have made an eternal impact on the lives of many people. May God bless your work, church, as we work together in God's kingdom work by our association, October 25th, 2015. We truly thank God for you.
Thank you.
And value your faithfulness.
Thank you, Lord.
Let's stand together.
Yeah.
And I will pray quickly, briefly, and we can go eat. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for your faithfulness to us. And we thank you that you allow us the honor of being a part of your kingdom work. And Father, we rejoice in what we celebrate today for those who have gone before us, those who are present, and those who will come after us in this place, whom you will draw to yourself and equip and use to build your kingdom in this area and the areas around it. So we thank you, Father, for who you are and allow us to be a part of your family and the work you do here on earth. We thank you, Father, for the food we're about to partake of. For those who've worked hard, Father, would you bless them? May the sound of our fellowship be a sweet sound in your ears as we meet together. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. God bless you.